subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Very good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for coming here. On behalf of the entire team of the Economic Survey, let me start by thanking the Honorable Prime Minister, the Honorable Finance Minister, and the Minister of State, Honorable Minister of State, for providing us this privilege to think deeply about the various aspects of the Indian economy, which is reflected in the Economic Survey. I'd also like to thank the Secretary of Economic Affairs and other secretaries for their inputs in the Economic Survey. I'd like to certainly place on record all my advisors who have worked very hard to prepare the Economic Survey and the team of the Economic Division who have worked extremely hard with unparalleled commitment to produce the second Economic Survey within a space of 6 months. My thanks goes to all the academics and the practitioners who also contributed to the survey. And last but not the least, we would like to, with all our deep gratitude, thank all those who actually gave us appreciative words and feedback on the previous version of the Economic Survey, which we've tried to incorporate to work even harder for this one. The theme for this year's Economic Survey is wealth creation. On the 15th of August, the Honorable Prime Minister spoke about wealth creation and mentioned that wealth creators need to be respected because wealth cannot be distributed unless it is created. The Honorable Finance Minister also insists that those who create wealth are indeed India's wealth. Inspired by these ideas, this year's Economic Survey, the theme is wealth creation. The cover of the Economic Survey, which is lavender, captures the 100 rupee new note, which is in this color, and combines the old with the new. The rupee symbol also captures the same theme about wealth. You have. So that is indeed the color, as Sanjeev is showing, the principal economic advisor. The Economic Survey, as I will explain in detail, is a synthesis of the ideas of old and new. As I just mentioned, the lavender color captures basically the new 100 rupee note together with the old note, which has been around for very long. And in terms of the ideas, the Economic Survey combines contemporary evidence that I'll share with ancient ideas. Therefore, it's a synthesis of the old and the new. But before I actually get into describing in detail the ideas in the survey, let me spend some time talking about the current economic scenario. There has been a slowdown in the Indian economy. Part of it is because of the global economy itself slowing down. You see here the world, the advanced economies, the emerging economies, and all groups of countries have actually slowed down in 2019 when compared to the averages for 2014 to 2018. In a globalized economy, India has also felt that effect. But there is one important aspect on which I will delve into greater detail, which needs attention from the perspective of the Indian economy, which is the financial sector. This chart shows the share of corporate loans in non-fruit credit starting from 2007 to 2019. What is quite relevant here to notice is this boom and bust, with 2013 being the peak when the share of corporate loans reached their peak. After that, it has decreased. Now, what is the impact of this on investment? If you want to understand the impact of this on investment, we can do the following exercise, which is take a 10-year period, split it into 2 5-year halves, look at the credit that a firm takes in the first 5 years, and then correlate it with the investment that the firm does in the next half. Now, if suppose the credit that they've taken actually is affecting investment negatively in the next 5-year period, then you should see a negative correlation with 2013 as being the break year. And that is the exercise that is being shown in the table. This is the result from regressions that we've run, what you see clearly is that it is indeed 2013 and the 10-year period from 2008 to 2017 where there is this negative correlation. In other words, firms that actually borrowed a lot more from 2008 to 2012, where indeed the firms that they also actually invested less from 2013 to 2017. Now, how does this affect GDP growth? As we had showed in the last economic survey on the virtuous cycle originates from private investment, which affects economic growth with a lag, and thereby consumption, and that's how the virtuous cycle proceeds. Now, what is important here is what is being shown on the right, which is the correlation of investment with GDP growth, with, you know, both contemporaneously and with lags. I want you to pay particular attention to the one that is being shown with the arrow, which is the if the correlation with a four-year lag, which is what is the impact on GDP growth this year due to the investment done 4 years back. That has a very strong positive correlation. If you look at the contemporaneous correlation, which is being shown in black, that is negative. Now, this is important for us to understand because as I just showed, the peak of the credit happened in 2013, and after that, there has been actually a decline in credit, which has affected investment as well. And it's that four-year lag as a result of which the slowdown in investment has led to the growth slide, you know, starting from 2017 onwards. Now, it is in this context that we actually focus in this year's economic survey on the theme of wealth creation. Wealth is both a cause and an effect of investment, especially private investment. Therefore, it is important for us to focus on wealth creation. In this context, it is quite pertinent to go back and look at the history, the recorded economic history. This chart shows that for close to three quarters of recorded economic history, India has been the dominant economic power in the world. So this chart goes from 180 to 2017. Obviously, the first 1,000 years are actually not up to scale. 1 to 1,000 is being shown in a smaller, you know, period on the x-axis. But what is critical here is that for three quarters of recorded economic history, India has been the dominant economic power. Such dominance does not happen by mere chance. Such dominance happens by design. And what is that element of design? It is indeed our emphasis on wealth. If you think about what our traditions say for the four noble human pursuits, which is dharma, earth, kama, moksha, earth is indeed about wealth. The canonical example, the canonical literature that is talked about is Arthashastra, but even many of our other ancient traditions also advocate wealth as wealth, you know, and wealth creation as indeed a noble pursuit. A very important piece of Tamil literature, which is the Thirukkural, talks about this in the chapter 76. Wealth, the lamp unfailing, speeds to every land, dispensing darkness at its Lord's command. Now, that is ancient thought, but how does that correlate with evidence that we have in recent times? To provide contemporary evidence on this, the exercise that we've done is to look at the top 100 entrepreneurs as measured using the Forbes list as of 2019, looked at the wealth that they've created over the last 10 years, applied necessary filters to ensure that the wealth was created in the right way, and correlated it with various other aspects of society. In this chart, what you see is that as there is an increase in the wealth created by our entrepreneurs, the largest entrepreneurs, the employees actually benefit as well from the salaries and the jobs that they get. A second dimension is those firms that supply to the firms of these entrepreneurs. And here, what is being shown is that the wealth created by these entrepreneurs benefits the suppliers as well because they end up supplying to these firms. A third way of looking at it is the foreign exchange revenue, which you all would understand matters for macro stability because those revenues affect our current account deficit and in turn macro stability. What you see here is that the wealth created by these entrepreneurs also correlates strongly with foreign exchange revenues. A final aspect is the, you know, what goes to the citizen through the government as the taxes that are paid by these entrepreneurs. What is being shown here is the direct taxes paid by these entrepreneurs, which clearly is an underestimate because there are various other indirect taxes that are also paid. But what is important here is a strong correlation between the wealth created by these entrepreneurs and the direct taxes that are paid. Because, and this goes back to what the Honorable Prime Minister, you know, said in his Independence Day speech, unless wealth is created, it cannot be distributed. And for distribution, it's basically taxes that are the primary instrument. Now, as I had mentioned, that India dominated economic activity for 3/4 of known economic history, and that doesn't happen by accident. It requires design. So what is that element of the design that indeed led to such economic dominance? The economic survey posits that it is the combination of the invisible hand of the market supported by the hand of trust, which is what leads to wealth creation. And here, there are, you know, important pieces of literature which we actually quote from. Take, for instance, to support the idea of the invisible hand of the market from Arthashastra, which says, the root of wealth is economic activity, and lack of it brings material distress. In the absence of fruitful economic activity, both current prosperity and future growth are in danger of destruction. In fact, the Arthashastra also commends the king to actually remove all obstacles to economic activity, which you would think about in contemporary times as economic freedom. If you look at the hand of trust, in the same chapter from which I quoted from the Thirukkural, says Thiruvalluvar says, wealth yields righteousness and joy, the wealth acquired capably without causing any harm, which is about the hand of trust. So now I'm going to provide evidence on these aspects. Before that, let me just mention that the economic survey, building on this idea that the combination of the invisible hand of the market has to be combined with the hand of trust, introduces this idea that trust is a public good which gets enhanced with greater use. Consider the example of water as a public good. As we use it more, it gets depleted. But the beauty about trust is that the more it gets used, the more the value of it gets enhanced. Of course, conversely, it's also true that if it does not get used, then the value of it declines as well. That's the characteristic of a public good, which gets enhanced with greater use. In trying to pursue wealth creation in the Indian economy, the economic survey brings out 10 main ideas, which is first that wealth creation benefits all, the invisible hand of the market enables wealth creation, trust is a public good that increases with use, grassroots entrepreneurs, which we basically have evidence in the second chapter of the survey, using evidence from 504 districts in India, showing that grassroots entrepreneurs indeed create wealth in their districts. Pro-business policies, you know, those that provide equal opportunity, are important for wealth creation. In order for wealth creation, it's also important to remove some of the anachronistic government interventions that have actually subsisted. Job creation, which is very important in the Indian context today, can be furthered significantly by integrating Assemble in India for the World into the Make in India campaign. The survey goes into great detail about how the ease of doing business can be enhanced by implementing specific suggestions to bring India within the first 50 in the rankings in the World Bank's ease of doing business rankings. The survey highlights that the banking sector, when you compare the size of the economy, is at this point subscale, and that is something that we need to think about. Finally, in keeping with the spirit of making economics relate to the common person, the economic survey brings the idea of thalinomics, which is the economics of a plate of food in India. Let me give you some evidence about the role of the invisible hand of the market in generating wealth. Of course, India's GDP and GDP per capita have increased significantly after liberalization. In this chart, what is being shown is the wealth that is created from the perspective of the stock market. What is quite interesting to note here, what is being plotted, is every milestone that the Sensex achieved. You know, 5,000 milestone. If you notice the first half, which is the phase one accelerated growth, while it took about 170 months for the first milestone of 5,000 to be reached, the subsequent milestones were reached much, much faster. And that's the first phase of accelerated growth. By the way, this is not just because of a scale effect. It is the increase in the growth rates that actually accounts for this acceleration. A second phase from 2007 to 2014, when it took about 80 months for the next milestone to be achieved. And then a third phase of revival again, where the milestones are being reached faster. Also notice that the last milestone from 35,000 to 40,000 has taken a little longer, which is actually also reflective of the slowdown in growth that we talked about. A few other examples, if you look at it from various sectors, this shows the banking sector. When the entry of private sector banks was allowed in the early 90s, look at the growth rate in the penetration of credit before and the penetration after. It's significantly higher. Similarly, another example, take the mutual fund sector, which when it was opened up in early 2000s, by breaking up UTI, look at the growth rates before and after. Again, significant difference. Another way of looking at the same thing, the impact of economic freedom and openness on generating wealth, is to distinguish various sectors. Here, an apples-to-apples comparison is being made within the transport sector. Take an open sector like roads and contrast it with a closed sector like railways. And here what is being shown is the freight traffic. The freight traffic for the open sector increased at exponential rates, much higher than the closed sector. And this effect is even more pronounced when you look at it from the perspective of passenger traffic, where you again find the open sector increasing at much higher rate than the closed sector. So in sum, these and other evidences that are there in the first chapter clearly articulate that the invisible hand of the market really and openness enables actually growth, not only at the aggregate level, but also at the sectoral level. The other important pillar, as I just mentioned, is the hand of trust. If you look at the Transparency International's Corruption Perception Index, 2011 is when India actually was at its low. If you correlate that with a different way of looking at the same thing, which is there is a break here provided in 2011 when the report on the 2G spectrum allocation was brought out. If you look at it, what is clear here is that connected companies, which are basically which is the line that is shown in red, vis-a-vis those that actually, the purple line for the BSE Sensex, before 2011, the connected companies actually earned much higher returns. But then there is a scissor-like movement after 2011 with the same connected companies earning lower returns since then. This is an important aspect because it relates to trust in the system and the difference between the pro-business policies that enable opportunity versus pro-crony policies that can favor incumbents, which is the chapter 3 of the economic survey. Another way of showing the same thing is the quality of financial statements. The Reserve Bank of India pointed out some of the large defaulters. What this chart shows is the financial statement quality of these large defaulters, 11 of them, by comparing it with the median financial statement quality in 3 years, 2012, 2013, and 2014, the median level, which captures basically what is the level of financial statement quality for the average firm, vis-a-vis that for these 11 large defaulters. And what is very clear is that even in 2012 to 2014, these indicators of financial statement quality were giving some signs. And it is important in the context of trust to actually keep in mind that when there are large firms whose financial statements are not as dependable, then it creates a trust deficit for other firms as well, because the average investor then starts thinking about the financial statement quality of every firm. A different way of looking at the same thing is by looking at the wealth erosion by willful defaulters, which is being compared with some of the large subsidy heads in the budget. One way of saying this is that if this money were not lost, we could have been spending almost double on our social sector, which benefits the common person. For instance, if you look at the health, education, and social protection, the spending that is done, it's almost the same as that for willful defaulters. Or if this money possibly had been spent on, you know, on improving the capital, if this hadn't been lost, it could have possibly been spent on capital expenditures in the railways, which again benefits the common person by enabling, you know, that person better travel. I was actually talking about telltale signs, you know, for willful defaulters. Here, what is being done is the comparison between willful defaulters versus non-defaulters in the top panel, and willful defaulters versus distressed defaulters in the bottom panel. And here, if you look at in terms of the disclosure of related party transactions, the promoter holding that is pledged, or the loans that are given to related parties, clearly willful defaulters differ significantly from either non-defaulters or distressed defaulters. And these are signs that actually, again, important, which I'll come back to later. One other way of looking at this is the way, you know, take one particular bank that has actually declared a particular borrower as a defaulter, and does another bank reflect the same? This, if you see, from 2014 onwards till 2019, this has secularly increased, which is consistent with the cleanup of the banking system that has happened over the last 5 years. Now let me spend some time on the important instrument for wealth creation that we must rely on. This chart here shows the widespread new firm creation that is happening at the level of districts in India. Think about the movie Band Baja Barat, where this protagonist, Shruti Kakkad, actually says that, "Main India ki best wedding planner banungi." It looks like from this map, clearly, that there are many, many Shrutis like that all over the districts in India. In fact, those people in the south would also be able to relate with the movie Aha Kalyanam, where again Shruti is the same protagonist. What is important is also to take into account that these entrepreneurs at the grassroots level are also helping the local economy, because an improvement in new firm creation also leads to GDP growth. An increase of 10% in the new firm creation translates into an increase of 1.8% in the GDP growth in the district. If you go by the World Bank data for new firm creation, it has picked up pace since 2014. The annual growth rate up till 2014, if you compare with 2006, was 3.8%, while that after 2014 is 12.2%. And what is quite important actually to keep in mind here is that the new firm creation is particularly pronounced in the services sector, which also is consistent with a macro fact that, you know, we know very well that is a service sector that is an important contributor to value added in India. So the micro data using entrepreneurship at the district level is consistent with the macro data saying that services sector is a really important contributor to value added. I spoke about some of the pro-crony policies, and I'm now going to contrast it with pro-business policies that enable opportunity. What is being shown here is the churn in the index. When we compare the 1986 index vis-a-vis the 1997 index, which is pre-liberalization versus after post-liberalization. What is quite clear is that if a firm was in the Sensex pre-liberalization, it could expect to be in the Sensex for a long, long time. In contrast, after liberalization, there is significant churn. By the time 9 years happen, about a third of the firms that actually were there in the Sensex originally are present. which shows the churn that is happening in terms of firms, in terms of sectors, the technologies that they bring. This is a very important point for wealth creation, because when you have new technologies, new firms coming in, not only do they benefit by bringing in these technologies, but more importantly, they keep the incumbents on their toes by providing them healthy competition. Now, this is also apparent if you look at the way the Sensex has evolved in terms of the various sectors that are dominating the Sensex. Notice that if you looked at in 1986, it's the materials sector and the consumer discretionary sector which was a large contributor to the Sensex in terms of the value added. But if you look at it today, their presence actually decreased significantly. A sector like the information technology or the financial services sector, which was not even existent in 1986, now has significant presence in the Sensex, which is basically consistent with the churn that is happening post-liberalization. This is a very important aspect of wealth creation, which is pro-business policies that provide opportunities to the incumbents, to the entrants, to be able to compete on a level playing field with the incumbents. Another important aspect of wealth creation is basically looking at laws that possibly have lost their relevance at this point in time, and look at the unintended consequences that can be created when government intervenes where there is no need for such a thing to happen. One example that I'm going to pick is the Essential Commodities Act, which was enacted in 1955. The Indian economy in 1955 was a very different economy to what it is today. The 1955 India was one that had actually had suffered the ravages of famines, food shortages, and had just emerged, you know, after the Second World War and independence. And therefore, the kind of market failures that the economy faced at that point in time were very different from what it is today. Today, India is an economy where food is produced in, you know, more than demand. So food shortages are a thing of the past. So it's very important, therefore, to make a distinction between storage and hoarding. If traders are unable to store, then they will not be able to basically smooth prices. So this distinction needs to be made. We should not be looking at every storer as necessarily a hoarder. And that is what is important if we have to think about bringing in more investment into the food processing industry, into the storage sector, then this view has to change. And here's the evidence is quite important. If you look at the prices of potato and onion, you know, onion, as you know, suffered a production shock, but the imposition of stock limits does not really have much of an effect on the volatility in prices. So potato is shown as a control here compared with onion. You know, the imposition of stock limits does not have much of an impact. Now, this is not something that is, you know, of a recent phenomenon. If you go to other instances, if you look at the stock limits that were imposed on gram, you know, in 2006, 2007, or if you look at sugar versus salt, the same pattern is obtained there as well. So the point that is being made here is that some of these anachronistic laws that were actually created at different point in time when the Indian economy was different need to be rethought, and possibly thereby the cost that they create for the economy can be minimized. As you all would acknowledge, job creation is a very important aspect of the Indian economy, and here's where exports can play a critical role. What this slide does is compares India's performance in exports vis-a-vis China and splits that into the effect of specialization, which is picking a few sectors and really digging deep into it, versus diversification. What you notice here is that the entire difference in export performance between India versus China is accounted for by specialization. China has specialized in the labor-intensive sectors and has thereby created lots of jobs, while India has not been able to do so. India's performance on diversification across product categories is quite similar to China. In other words, when we look at our presence in various product categories, we are doing very similar to China, but the main difference comes from the difference in specialization. And so what is important really is today for us to focus on specializing and picking especially the labor-intensive sectors, which are actually, you know, our comparative advantage given the labor force that we have. And for this, the sixth chapter in the economic survey, fifth chapter, makes a very, very clear case for focusing on these labor-intensive sectors. To give you an example, take the iPhone, which is, you know, assembled in China. If you take every iPhone, China, the value added that it creates on every iPhone is about $8.50, which dwarfs compared to the value added that, you know, a Japan or a United States actually creates in these in an iPhone. But the important effect that China actually has is the scale, which is that every iPhone, almost every iPhone, at least till recently, was assembled in China. So when you take a per unit, which is about $8.50, but multiply it with a large scale, you get exports that are significant, and in the process, significant jobs are created as well. The economic survey this year has actually done an estimation that if India were to actually follow a similar path, and I'll come to why this is the opportune moment, that India can create significant opportunities. Export of network products is expected to be about $7 trillion worldwide by 2025. Network products are those that are actually manufactured across global value chains. These include industries like telecom equipment, mobile phones, of course, you know, photographic machinery, etc. There are six sectors which actually form part of these network products. By focusing on this particular sector, which, as I said, has a market of about $7 trillion worldwide by 2025, India can generate about a quarter of the value added that is required for it to achieve the export side, the $5 trillion economy, and quite importantly, generate about 4 crore well-paid jobs by 2025 and 8 crore jobs by 2030. This is about basically enabling imports of components in India, assembling them, and exporting it without being, you know, judgmental about the process, just focusing on generating jobs through exports of this nature. Why is this opportunity now? Because if you look at the countries that actually, you know, examples of Japan, Korea, China, they are now at a phase where they basically, their presence in these network products is declining. And therefore, the opportunity for India is significant. Together with the current trade environment, with the trade war that is going on, this is possibly the best opportunity for India to actually, you know, really latch on to this particular benefit for job creation. As I had mentioned earlier, one of the very important aspects of wealth creation is economic freedom. And here, the ease of doing business is really critical. While India has certainly made strides in improving its performance in the ease of doing business, especially we've gone up from being ranked 142 in 2014 to 63rd in 2019, it still is the case that India lags behind on a few areas, which is ease of starting business, registering property, paying taxes, and enforcing contracts. To give you some illustrative examples, if you want to open a restaurant in Delhi, you need about 45 documents to obtain the necessary license from Delhi Police. If you want to buy a gun, you need 19 documents. If you want to set up a new firm in India, it takes about 18 days, on average 18 days, with about 10 procedures that can be often cumbersome. Just contrast it to the best in business, which is New Zealand. In New Zealand, it takes half a day. You fill one form, and boom, your business is started. So this chapter makes very, very specific suggestions that need to be focused on so that India can really improve its rank and get into the top 50 in the EODB rankings. A very important dimension of any economy is the banking sector. And the Indian banking sector, despite the enormous size of our economy, we are currently the fifth largest economy, is subscale. What this chart shows is the number of banks that are there in the global top 100 country-wise. China leads the table. India comes quite far behind with one bank in the top 100. Even countries like Singapore and Sweden, which are a fraction of our size, they have triple the number of large banks. Now, if our banking sector were proportional to the size of the economy, India should have had 6 banks in the global top 100. And by the time we become a $5 trillion economy, we should have 8 banks in the top 100. Now, there are other ways of looking at the same thing, which is if you plot the GDP per capita, this here actually shows the size of the economy and the number of banks. What you notice here clearly is that India is a negative outlier. That's the line of fit is where basically, you know, India should be. If India had a proportionate banking sector, India seems a negative outlier, with China being a positive outlier. Notice United States is on the line. Another way of looking at the same thing is, you know, compare the how developed the economy is and the penetration of credit in the economy. What is being plotted here on the x-axis is the GDP per capita and the private credit to GDP on the y-axis. Here again, India is a negative outlier. If India's banking sector were proportional to the level of advancedness of the economy, our credit penetration should have been about 90%, which is about 80% more than what it is today. One other way of looking at it, because you know the concern could come up that this is all because of our population. We have a very large population, and therefore the penetration of the banking sector is low. Even if you control for the effect of population, clearly countries that actually are more populated have lower credit penetration. But even taking that into account, India still has significantly lower credit penetration. So the point being made here is that compared to the size of the economy, at this point, the economy is you know, the banking sector needs to scale up and become proportional to the size of the economy. And in this, there have been several reports that have looked at the banking sector, you know, starting from the Narasimhan Committee 1 and 2, the Rajan Committee, the PJ Nayak Committee, which have made recommendations which can be considered. The economic survey gives one key idea. And this goes back, you know, when I did my BTech in electrical engineering, my BTech thesis was on using neural networks for electrical engineering, which is an application of artificial intelligence and machine learning. Today, that has actually become really, really critical in the banking sector. So the idea that the economic survey is advocating is a public sector banking network, which will enable analytics, artificial intelligence, and machine learning for better decisions. If you remember when I talked about trust, I focused on several leading indicators, be it financial statement quality, be it the differences between willful defaulters and others, and these were actually indicators that were flashing 2-3 years back. And this is something that data can really pick up, just plain simple data. Of course, artificial intelligence and machine learning can do a far better job in trying to actually identify patterns that can really avoid this phenomenon. So the idea that is being advocated here is to build a network, use the data within the frameworks, legal frameworks of data, use the data across the various public sector banks to really enable better decision making, especially on corporate lending. And that is where really the data can be quite critical. The NBFC sector, as you all know, has actually gone through some recent difficulties. So the economic survey builds a health index to track financial fragility in the NBFC sector. And if you notice here, this is the index for the housing finance sector, which shows that from 2014 itself, there were early signs which could have actually been picked up. This is another idea that has been built up in the economic survey to try and actually enable policymakers to be able to track the financial fragility in the NBFC sector. Last but not the least, in the previous survey, we had made a humble effort to try and relate economics with a common person using behavioral economics. In this survey, we actually are introducing Thalinomics, which is the economics of a plate of food in India. There is no better way, at least in the opinion of the team of the economic survey, than to relate economics with a common person by using the plate of food that a person consumes every day. So what the survey has done is looked across 28 states, the different meals that people consume, built the, you know, taken each component, which is cereals, pulses, vegetables, even the garnishing that happens from turmeric to garlic to others, and really calculated what is the price of a thali that a person would pay across 28 states. And what is, you know, quite interesting to note is that if you look at the trend in the thali prices that prevailed till 2015-16, if that trend had prevailed, as you notice in the chart on the left, there has been a clear moderation in the, you know, in prices. Compared to that trend, an average household, industrial household that has five individuals and eats two vegetarian thalis a day has benefited by about rupees 10,000, you know, on an annual basis, which basically captures the benefits that they've gone. Notice here that the prices of thalis this year have increased. So this index is indeed capturing what is happening on the ground as well. And what you see on the right is a measure of affordability of the thali, which is what percentage of the earnings of an average industrial worker does it go in just having two thalis for a household of five individuals. What is very clear here is that since 2006-2007, affordability has increased significantly due to various policy measures. So the next few charts I'm going to show is for the different states across across various parts of India. This is basically the intention here is that, you know, whether you are here in Lutyens, Delhi, having a dinner table conversation, or you are in a roadside dhaba somewhere in the hinterland, you can have debates about the question about saying, has a thali become costlier or has it become cheaper? You can also ask questions like, is a vegetarian thali actually cheaper or the non-vegetarian? Where has been the inflation greater? Which components have really contributed to increase or decrease in the price of the thalis? Questions like these that can really spur a quote-unquote healthy debate can now be indulged in using this index of thali prices that the Thalinomics builds. Once again, let me thank you very much for your patient listening, and I'm happy to take questions.
Before we take questions, picture with the father release of the document here. Thank you. Yeah, so first question from 33.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Shishir from Hindu Business Line. So I have two very basic questions, sir. Sir, you talked about invisible hand and trust. So, and you also talked about $5 trillion economy, that what needs to be done on that thing. Have you changed the timeline for $5 trillion economy achievable? And the second thing is that what about the consumption? Will the consumption come from the trust factor or from the invisible hand factor?
So to your first question, to my knowledge, there is no change in the deadline. The second question, which is about consumption, you know, we had discussed this in the last year's economic survey, and I actually just alluded to it here as well, that the virtuous cycle, you know, which is basically goes from investment to growth, and growth puts demand in the hands of people, and that affects consumption. There has been slowdown in consumption as well, which in the State of the Economy chapter we talk about.
116.
सर मेरा सवाल बैंकिंग सेक्टर पर है अभी जब फाइनेंशियल स्टेबिलिटी रिपोर्ट आई थी आरबीआई की तो उन्होंने बोला था कि ग्रॉस एनपीए में और भी ज़्यादा वृद्धि होगी सितंबर 2020 तक 9.9% फ्रॉम 9.3% तो क्या और क्रेडिट ऑफ टेक भी कुछ खास नहीं है और एनबीएफसीज के साथ जो को लेंडिंग मॉडल है वो भी बहुत सक्सेसफुल नहीं रहा तो आपको लगता है कि सरकार को फिर से एक बहुत बड़े स्केल पर कैपिटल इन्फ्यूज करने की ज़रूरत है
देखिए हमने इस साल के जो आर्थिक समीक्षा है उसमें बड़े प्रश्नों पे ध्यान दिया है और हमने ये बताया जैसे हमने प्रेजेंटेशन में भी दिखाया कि हमारी जो अर्थव्यवस्था है जो आज की तारीख में पांचवी है विश्व में उसके मुकाबले जो हमारी बैंकिंग सेक्टर है वो एक्चुअली आज के तारीख में थोड़ी छोटी है और हमने इसीलिए इसमें आइडियाज़ दिए हैं जिससे यह बैंकिंग सेक्टर और समृद्ध बन सके और जो $5 trillion इकोनॉमी है उसके लिए और अग्रसर हो सके हम
12
Sir, Timsi Jaipuria from CNBC TV 18. My question is regarding the 6.5% growth that you have pitched in the economic survey. What makes you positive on getting this as early as next fiscal itself? Because currently you've pegged GDP growth at 5% and now you're looking at 6.5%.
6 to 6.5.
What makes you hopeful, and what are the early signs that you're seeing to see this 1 to 1.5% growth?
So I think, you know, in an earlier presentation, I had talked about the steps that have been taken by the government. And there are some early signs. What is also important is if you look at the business cycle phenomena in India, typically the, you know, if you look at the peaks and the troughs, and you correlate it with what, you know, what has happened, it seems like there is actually, we have sort of hit a trough, and therefore there should be an uptick in the, you know, in growth, and that is what we're actually budgeting. Now, notice here that we actually have been, you know, we haven't gone and said it's 7.5%. We've actually kept it to 6 to 6.5.
25.
सर, आपने थालीनॉमिक्स की बात की, कहा कि थाली की कीमतों में 2015-16 के बाद गिरावट आई, हालांकि पिछले कुछ दिनों पिछले दो सालों में थोड़ा बढ़ोतरी हुई है, लेकिन साथ ही साथ आप बात कर रहे हैं कि जो फूड सब्सिडी है उसमें भी कटौती की जानी चाहिए, कमी लाई जानी चाहिए, आपके इकोनॉमिक सर्वे का पार्ट है। तो मैं जानना चाह रहा हूँ कि जो फूड सब्सिडी में कटौती होगी और दूसरी तरफ दिख रहा है कि थाली में बढ़ोतरी होगी, एक आम आदमी है उसके लिए किस तरह से मैनेज करना होगा, क्योंकि सब्सिडी में सब्सिडी देना जरूरी है और देश में फूड सिक्योरिटी एक्ट भी लागू है।
देखिए, फूड सब्सिडी ये तो बहुत बड़ा मुद्दा है। हमने एक छोटी सी पहल करी है इस अध्याय में दिखाने के लिए कि जो 28 हमारे राज्य हैं उन राज्यों में कहाँ आप एक मांसाहारी या शाकाहारी थाली ले लें तो उनका दाम कितना है। और वो हमारा जो बड़ा मुद्दा है वो है, और उद्देश्य वो है कि आप जैसे लोग और बाकी जो काम सामान्य वर्ग है, वो सामान्य वर्ग एक्चुअली इसको लेके कि थाली हमारा एक्चुअली बढ़ गया दाम कि सस्ता हो गया, ये है बड़ा मुद्दा इसमें। और जहाँ तक आपका सब्सिडी का सवाल है, इसमें कोई दोहरा नहीं है कि थोड़ा बहुत जो 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 मॉडरेशन हुआ है वो सब्सिडी के कारण है, लेकिन ये एक बहुत बड़ा मुद्दा है जिसमें बहुत सारे पहलू हैं। एक पहलू आपने दर्शाया है, लेकिन बाकी सारे पहलुओं को भी साथ में लेना पड़ेगा इस मुद्दे पर रोशनी डालने के लिए।
114।
गुड आफ्टरनून सर, दिस इज चेतन फ्रॉम जी बिजनेस ऑन हियर। सर, सर कंसिडरिंग द फैक्ट आपने इकोनॉमिक सर्वे में एक्सपोर्ट्स पे काफ़ी फोकस दिया है, लेकिन आप क्या लेकिन हमने अभी तक एज इंडिया वी हैव नॉट एबल टू टेक एडवांटेज ऑफ US चाइना ट्रेड वॉर, तो व्हाट डू यू थिंक द स्ट्रेटजीज क्या होनी चाहिए जिससे हम लोग वी कैन बेटर परफॉर्म इन टर्म्स ऑफ एक्सपोर्ट्स एंड टेक बेटर एडवांटेजेस ऑफ प्रॉब्ली टू नेशंस कॉन्फ्लिक्टिंग एंड टेक बेटर एडवांटेजेस विद दैट सेक्टर एज वेल।
यही सवाल हमने एक्चुअली हमने अपने टीम में पूछा और इसीलिए ये अध्याय लिखा है। सारे जो जवाब आपने जो जिन प्रश्नों का जो को पूछा है उसके सारे जवाब इस अध्याय में हैं। मैंने कुछ उसके बारे में बताया कि एक तो जैसे प्राइमरीली हमें एक्चुअली जो लेबर इंटेंसिव सेक्टर्स हैं उसमें फोकस करना चाहिए, असेंबल इन इंडिया का जो हमने कहा, जिससे इसको यदि हम फॉलो करेंगे तो करीब 4 करोड़ जॉब्स एक्चुअली आ सकते हैं 2025 तक और 8 करोड़ 2030 तक। तो इसको इस मुद्दे पे बहुत केयरफुल हमने एक्चुअली सुझाव दिए हैं, और एक्चुअली संजीव साहब भी एक्चुअली कुछ कहना चाहेंगे।
हाँ, आप देखेंगे एक चैप्टर है ईज ऑफ डूइंग बिजनेस, उसको बहुत आप पढ़िएगा। उसमें हम लोगों ने देखा है कि जो लॉजिस्टिकल हमारा जो प्रोसेस फ्लो है उसमें कितना टाइम लगता है एक कारपेट को से मिर्ज़ापुर से US पहुंचने में, हर कदम उस प्रोसेस को मैं हम लोगों ने देखा है कि कितना समय लगता है, आप देखिएगा हमने दिखाया। फिर एक अपेरल्स कंसाइनमेंट को दिल्ली से US पहुंचने में, तो कैसे नवाशिवा पोर्ट पहुंचती है, नवाशिवा पोर्ट पे कौन कौन से प्रोसेस हैं उनमें कितना समय लगता है, फिर शिप से जाते, हर जगह आप देखेंगे इस समीक्षा में हमने एक केस स्टडीज काफ़ी सारे हैं, ये तो मैंने कुछ ही बताया। फिर इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स बेंगलुरु एयरपोर्ट में आप देखिएगा, इन सब का हम लोगों ने केस स्टडी किया है। तो एक मतलब एक्सपोर्ट कंपेटिटिवनेस के बहुत पहलू हैं, तो इसका ये भी एक अंश है।
नंबर और इसमें एक्चुअली और ऐड करना चाहूँगा, ये बहुत अच्छा पॉइंट संजीव साहब ने कहा कि ये अध्याय में ये भी दिखाया गया है कि जो हमारा समय लगता है, आप यदि एक्सपोर्ट्स और इंपोर्ट्स लें तो एक्सपोर्ट्स में ज़्यादा समय लगता है, और तो उसके लिए एक्चुअली स्पेसिफिक सुझाव भी दिए हैं जिनका अमल करके, जो आपने जो प्रश्न पूछा है और बाकी जो आइडियाज़ हैं उनको अमल करके इसका एक्चुअली हम लाभ उठा सकते हैं।
14 सॉरी नंबर 9 इज नॉट येट देयर, या प्लीज आस्क क्वेश्चन।
रविशंकर कपूर, फ्रीलांस जर्नलिस्ट। मिस्टर सुब्रमण्यन, व्हेन समबडी वांट्स टू इन्वेस्ट $1 billion इन इंडिया, ही इज रिटॉर्टेड बाय एन इकोनॉमिक मिनिस्टर। आई मीन, डू यू थिंक सच बिहेवियर इज कंपैटिबल विद wealth, respecting wealth creators?
So, I want to restrict my answers to the ideas that we've talked about in the economic survey. Thank you.
Number 14.
I'm Shubham Batra from Cogensis. Sir, can you talk a bit about the state of government finances currently, because that has a bearing on the growth targets that we've said. This is in terms of whether there's a likely relaxation or deviation, and what could be the quantum of this. If you could talk a bit about that, sir.
The second chapter in the volume 2 indeed actually delves into detail on all these aspects, and we've actually acknowledged there that if you look at the overall fiscal deficit over the 9-month period, it's similar to what it was in last year. But given the revenue situation, there may be possibly some slippage in the fiscal deficit. And we've also said that at the current situation, actually there is a need for a growth impetus. If Arun wants to add anything.
Slippage in the fiscal deficit. What kind of revenue slippages are you looking at? And secondly, your survey talks only about GST collections, the stabilization of late in the GST collections.
What about
direct taxes?
Wait for tomorrow.
Now, what about direct taxes? You did not mention about direct taxes in your survey. You've mentioned only about GST.
In fact, I would just like to draw your attention to, para 2.21 till about 7-8 more paras. And if you see, all we have discussed both the receipt side as well as the expenditure side. And then keeping in account that the demand is sluggish, then we have said that probably, yes, there could be a possibility, as he had said, for looking at the fiscal deficit target for the current year.
150.
This is Mukesh Kaushik from Daring Bhaskar, sir. In your chapter, Ease of Doing Business, you said that 45 documents are needed to open a restaurant and just 19 documents to avail a gun in Delhi. Is it a fallout that less restaurants are visible in Delhi now and guns are more visible?
So, I'll have Sanjeev actually add to what I have to say on this. Look, anything like this, is affected by many factors. When you look at a restaurant business versus, let's say, another business, there are many factors that affect it. We've focused primarily on the procedures, relating to ease of doing business. But you have to be a little careful, actually, not attributing all the differences to just one factor.
Number 8.
The thing is on restaurants, just to show you, that's just for one procedure, by the way, that 45 documents. The number of licenses you need in Delhi for getting a restaurant started is 26. In Chennai, in Bangalore, the number is something like 36 or 35. In Mumbai, it's 22. And each one of these requires those kinds of documents. So, for example, this 45 documents you need is just for one, for Puri's license, the permission that you have to get to do a license. It's there, the exact name of that thing is there. And for that you need 45 documents. For getting a police permission for getting arms was 19. That is the point being made. But by the way, there are many others. There are, in fact, you even need special permission to get for signage, for music, for even doing bicycle delivery, by the way. So you read it, we have listed out the kinds of permissions you need.
Number 8.
The economic survey discusses these issues, so that's...
I'm Nikunj Ohri from Bloomberg Quint. Sir, you spoke about the health of the banking sector. You said investment of every rupee in public sector banks has led to a loss of about 23 paise. So, and we've seen now the government has announced merger of public sector banks. So how do you think this can be tackled? And secondly, you said that we can make public sector banks more efficient by announcing employee stock options and giving them a position on the board. We've seen that also in the past. Some of the banks have announced ESOPs, but they've failed. So how do you think this can help in making public sector banks efficient?
As I had mentioned in the presentation, you know, there are many wise people who have actually looked at issues on this. There are reports. The new idea that the survey has brought in is the use of technology, and the incentives for employees that we've talked about is in that context. Because, you know, given the disruption that is happening with fintech, what is really critical is for the employees in any bank, you know, be it private sector or the public sector, for them to be at the cutting edge of technology. And, you know, that being at that technology frontier, using artificial intelligence, machine learning, etc., will not happen unless you have employees who actually have, you know, who are learning constantly and being at that cutting edge. And that's the idea with which actually this has been, you know, talked about. So there is a difference, important difference in the way, you know, the employee ownership has been looked at. And I think, you know, the... To your question, what we are basically saying is that apart from the recommendations that I've made by others, many of which actually are possibly are good ones and can be considered, here's actually a couple of others, which is in the, particularly the emphasis on technology, artificial intelligence, and machine learning, and enabling that by actually, you know, allowing employees to be owners.
38.
Sir, I'm Shishir Choroshia, from Amar Ujala. सर आपने मेंशन किया कि हमारी इकोनॉमी के मुकाबले बैंकिंग इंडस्ट्री छोटी है तो आपका आशय क्या है कि हम 100% हाउस होल्ड तक नहीं पहुंच पाए हैं या आबादी के लिहाज से उस तरह से शाखाओं की संख्या नहीं बढ़ी है या लेंडिंग नहीं बढ़ी है
नो हमने दिखाया था एक्चुअली जो आपने प्रश्न पूछ रहे हैं इनके बारे में एग्जैक्टली इन्हीं के बारे में हमने आंकड़े दिखाए थे तो हमने एक पहलू ये दिखाया था कि जब हमारे जो बैंक हैं जो ग्लोबल के जो ग्लोबल मतलब देश विदेश में जो 100 बैंक हैं टॉप 100 बैंक हैं उनमें एक्चुअली हम भारत के उतनी ज़्यादा गणना नहीं है एक और पहलू से देखें तो जो प्राइवेट क्रेडिट टू जीडीपी जो कहते हैं जो मतलब क्रेडिट कितना पहुंचा है दूर दराज तक उसमें देखें तो भी उसमें भी एक्चुअली उसमें बढ़ोतरी हो सकती है और ये सिर्फ हमारे हमारी आबादी के कारण नहीं है ये हमने दिखाया है
109
सर मनोज कुमार फ्रॉम रॉयटर्स न्यूज एजेंसी सर व्हाट आर द ब्रॉड रिस्क टू द दिस पर्पल कवर्ड इकोनॉमिक सर्वे विच टॉक्स अबाउट थालीनॉमिक्स दिस टाइम कंपेयर टू बिकॉज लास्ट टाइम आल्सो वी हैड दिस ब्लू स्काई इकोनॉमिक्स गिविंग ए एस्टिमेट ऑफ 7% एंड विच हैज नाउ बीन कट डाउन टू 5% एंड यू आर स्टिल टॉकिंग अबाउट लाइक सो ए गवर्नमेंट नीड्स टू एक्सपेंड द फिस्कल डेफिसिट फॉर दिस ईयर And a supplementary question, so what could be the possible impact of this coronavirus on the Indian economy, in the short, thank you.
I think your last question I can answer easily, which is that I'm not a doctor to be able to actually tell you. I think it may be a very marginal, if you look at even the, you know, SARS phenomenon that happened earlier, one can go and look at the data there and what was the impact to be able to, I don't think there would actually be that, you know, that big an impact on the economy. It's a very marginal. Now, with respect to your first question, which is, see, about the risks, you know, I think the ideas themselves, actually implementing those ideas is where the benefits are inherent in. And possibly not implementing some of those actually may be the ones that actually can generate some of the risks.
116.
सर समीर दीक्षित जी बिजनेस से सर आपने लास्ट टाइम जब सर्वे पेश किया था तब आपने पूरा जोर दिया था कि प्राइवेट इन्वेस्टमेंट आना चाहिए इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर में पिछले एक साल में कोई भी मेजर प्राइवेट इन्वेस्टमेंट नज़र नहीं आया है रेलवेज में भी कोई भी नाम गिनाने के लिए नहीं है रोड सेक्टर में भी मेजर नहीं है इस बार आप वेल्थ क्रिएशन पर जोर दे रहे हैं प्राइवेट इन्वेस्टमेंट की तरफ से ये जो बेरुखी है इसकी वजह आपको क्या लगती है क्या आपको लगता है कि मेजर जो भी आपने गाइडलाइंस दिए थे सजेशंस दिए थे काम नहीं किए और दूसरा सर जो पब्लिक सेक्टर बैंक्स को लेकर के लगातार पूछा जा रहा है आपके क्या लगता है कि क्या वो 5 या 3 बड़े कदम हो सकते हैं जो पब्लिक सेक्टर बैंक्स को सुधारने में कारगर साबित होंगे?
हमने शायद ये दूसरा प्रश्न आप काफ़ी बार अभी जवाब दे दिया है इसके बारे में, तो हम पहला प्रश्न आपका हाँ प्राइवेट इन्वेस्टमेंट और इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के बारे में था ना। देखिए कुछ दिन पहले सरकार ने 100 लाख करोड़ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर इन्वेस्टमेंट की, एक्चुअली जो जितने सारे अप्रूवल्स हैं उसका एक कमिटी भी थी सेक्रेटरी इकोनॉमिक अफेयर्स के नेतृत्व में जिसने उस पर देखा है। आपको एक चीज़ ये ध्यान रखना है कि इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर जो इन्वेस्टमेंट है, जो निवेश होता है, वो बड़ा निवेश होता है और वो एक्चुअली उसको उसमें निर्णय करने में प्राइवेट इन्वेस्टर्स को ये नहीं है कि आज रात भर आपने सोचा और चलो कल सुबह हमने इन्वेस्ट कर लिया इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर में, वो क्योंकि ये इतना बड़ा प्रोजेक्ट होता है और जिसमें एक्चुअली काफ़ी सारी एनालिसिस ज़रूरत होती है। तो ये एक मुद्दा है जिसे आप ध्यान रखें जब आप इस प्रश्न को पूछ रहे हैं। इसीलिए सरकार ने एक्चुअली जो पहल की है अगले 5 साल में 100 लाख करोड़ इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर के लिए, उस बारे में मैं कह रहा था कि वो पहल जो है उसका थोड़ा समय दें, उसका एक्चुअली उसका परिणाम आएगा।
नंबर 57।
हेलो, मैं सैयद आमिर हुसैन हूँ न्यूज़ नेशन से। 2 मेजर क्वेश्चन है सर। पहला ये कि पिछले 8-9 महीने में देखा गया कि डिमांड काफ़ी डिक्रीज हुई, खासतौर पे ऑटो सेक्टर में जिस तरह से जॉब्स लॉस हुए हैं, उससे निपटने के लिए क्या आपको लगता है आने वाले समय में इसमें बढ़ोतरी होगी, सुधार आएंगे? दूसरा ये कि किसानों की आय दुगनी करने के लिए 2022 तक का टारगेट रखा गया है, प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी ने कई मंचों से इसको लेकर के कहा है, उसका बहुत ज़्यादा जिक्र नहीं दिख रहा है।
देखिए हमने जो एसेंशियल कमोडिटीज़ एक्ट के बारे में जो बात करी ये काफ़ी अहम है, जो आपने जो दूसरा प्रश्न पूछा है उसके लिए। जब हम वो आंकड़े दिखा रहे थे तब भी हमने कहा कि यदि हमें वहाँ उसमें स्टोरेज की ज़रूरत है, फूड प्रोसेसिंग इंडस्ट्री को बढ़ावा देना है, तो हमें एक्चुअली जो लिमिट्स वगैरह लगाते हैं जिनका उतना असर पड़ता नहीं है, इस पर ध्यान देने की ज़रूरत है। तो आपका कहना एक्चुअली कुछ हद तक सही है कि हमने एग्रीकल्चर पे स्पेसिफिकली लिखा नहीं है, लेकिन ये मुद्दा हमने ज़रूर रोशन किया है कि यदि फूड प्रोसेसिंग स्टोरेज वगैरह का इम्प्रूव करना है तो बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट है। और जैसे संजीव जी याद दिला रहे थे कि हमें ये फ़र्क करना है, यदि जो स्टोरर्स हैं और होल्डर्स में, इसमें ये दोनों को एक्चुअली हम यदि एक साथ एक मिलजुल के देखें तो उससे थोड़ी हानि होती है। और ये इस मुद्दे पे इकोनॉमिक सर्वे ने, आर्थिक समीक्षा ने रोशनी डाली है, जो किसानों की आय बढ़ाने में एक्चुअली एक बहुत अहम मुद्दा है।
नंबर 17।
हाँ, पहला
के और डिमांड इंक्रीज को लेकर के, डिमांड काफी डाउन हुई,
उसमें हमने एक्चुअली जैसे हमने प्रेजेंटेशन में भी दिखाया काफी सारे कदम हमने बताए, जो हमने एक्सपोर्ट्स के बारे में कहा। अब स्पेसिफिक सेक्टर के बारे में, ये ऑटो सेक्टर के बारे में तो बहुत सारी बातचीत हो चुकी है, कुछ नया बोलते हैं।
नंबर 34।
सर 17 सर, विकास धूत फ्रॉम द हिंदू। इट्स आई एम श्योर इट्स क्वाइट रीअश्योरिंग फॉर इंडस्ट्री एंड मार्केट्स वेयर यू नो द थीम ऑफ द सर्वे दैट यू सिलेक्टेड टॉकिंग अबाउट वेल्थ क्रिएशन एंड द इनविजिबल हैंड ऑफ द मार्केट and also you talked about removing anachronistic government interventions
and the hand of trust
of course. So also later on you've gone on to talk about how job creation can be dramatically pushed by ensuring that we join the network sectors where we can
network industry sectors
which will basically help us boost our export surplus, and in the process you've talked about making our tariff lines slightly more open and not be judgmental, like you said, about bringing in inputs from abroad and then assembling it and sending it abroad. So given that our also you talked about price controls being a problem with whether it's drugs or food, so given that what the survey is advocating on these lines, this will basically need a reversal of the way our increasing tendency that has been seen in recent years, where we have raised our tariff walls on several products and goods, and we've also been trying to micromanage price controls, whether it's on drugs or medical devices. So basically the survey is looking at a reboot of the current trade policy.
No, I think, you know, I would want to, you know, correct what you're saying. There is a difference between components that are used for assembling and finished goods. So what we are talking about is about enabling imports of components so that they can be assembled in India and exported, which can really create jobs. Okay, so that's the, you know, that I think that nuance is important for you to keep in mind. Second, as I showed you, it's not today. The Essential Commodities Act, as I said, has been in existence since 1955, when the economy was very, very different from what it is today. As I mentioned, an economy that has actually, that had just undergone ravages of famine, food shortages, the mindset was very different. Today, the mindset is very different. And importantly, what we showed is the evidence of such interventions not working, not just now, but earlier as well. I think that is important. It's a secular point that we are making, not just about current, but also about, you know, the past as well, for a very long period across sectors. And that's the way this needs to be interpreted. It's, you know, that's really critical to be able to look at it in that way, which is that, you know, on the export side, let's basically focus on components. And here, wherever actually there is no need, because remember that, you know, what we are saying is intervention by the government is required when there is what economists call market failure. Now, in 1955, the market failures that the Indian economy had were far, far greater than they are today. And therefore, this prism of market failure and the difference between what it was in 1955 versus today, or even up till the late 80s, etc., that prism needs to be brought in being able to see some of these anachronistic laws. That's the point we're making.
34.
The question is somewhat related to what was just asked. You have spoken basically about how government interventions can create market inefficiencies. Okay. So basically, today the president in his speech to both houses of parliament has said that buy local for a better tomorrow, basically pushing for the Swadeshi mantra. So do you think, how do you reconcile of what you have said that market government interventions can create market inefficiencies and the push for Swadeshi? I mean.
As I actually, you know, highlighted very clearly, we've provided both contemporary evidence and, you know, shown a lot of ancient thinking as well to make the case that we should be doing what is good for India. I've answered the question.
87 on the top.
Sir, this is Sanjeev Shekhar from Aryavart. Yeah, GST says related, sir, question here. ये जीएसटी का जो रिव्यू आया है आपके मंत्रालय से सोर्सेज से 200 करोड़ का पर मंथ का चोरी हो रहा है और ये फेल्योर भी हो रहा है कलेक्शन में रिकवरी में तो इसका तीसरा एजेंसी को प्राइवेट एजेंसी को आपने दे रखा है मॉनिटरिंग के लिए और ये जो इनजस्टिस हो रहा है आपके मिनिस्ट्री में इस तरह से तो इस पर क्या करना है दूसरा आपने क्लेम किया है कि 6.5 जीडीपी का आपने क्लेम किया है बट रियलिटी में क्या है जीडीपी रेट्स का इम्प्रूवमेंट का आप दो क्वेश्चन है आपके लिए
सो दूसरे सवाल पे एक्चुअली हमने पूरा अध्याय लिखा है जो आप चैप्टर 10 इकोनॉमिक सर्वे का आर्थिक समीक्षा का देखें अच्छा है आपने ये सवाल पूछा हमने इस मुद्दे पे रोशनी डालने की कोशिश की है क्योंकि ये पिछले दिनों में कई बार ये ऐसा ये एक मुद्दा आया है कि हमारे ग्रोथ रेट सही हैं या गलत और जबकि हमारा ग्रोथ रेट अभी थोड़ा कम हुआ है तो ये मुद्दा और भी अहम हो जाता है क्योंकि जब भी कोई उद्योगपति निवेश करता है तो वो जीडीपी की जो दर है वृद्धि की दर है उसको देख के एक्चुअली निवेश करता है तो इसमें हमने ये दिखाया है और इस अध्याय को आप ज़रूर पढ़ें क्योंकि आपने ये सवाल पूछा है कि यदि हम केयरफुली उसकी तुलना करें अब जैसे यदि ग्रोथ का आपको तुलना करना है तो आपको विभिन्न देशों को देखना है लेकिन अब जैसे भारत देश है ये एक्चुअली किसी और देश से बहुत अलग है जब आप एक सही तुलना करते हैं, मतलब आप सेव लें और सेव की सेव को सेव से तुलना करें, ना कि सेव को आपने संतरे के साथ तुलना कर दी, तो यदि आप सेव को लेके संतरे के साथ तुलना करेंगे तो एक्चुअली हम ये दिखाते हैं उसमें कि भारत की जो वृद्धि दर है वो एक्चुअली उसमें करीब 2.7% का फर्क आता है। लेकिन सिर्फ भारत का ही नहीं, 95 देश जो हमने उस एनालिसिस में, उस विश्लेषण में इंक्लूड किया है, 51 देशों में भी वो फर्क आता है। लेकिन जब आप एक्चुअली सेव का सेव से तुलना करते हैं, सही तुलना करते हैं, तो ये जो 52 देश हैं भारत को मिला के, इनमें कोई फर्क नहीं आता है। और इसके अलावा एक ऑब्जर्वेशन रखना चाहूँगा, जैसे मैंने कहा कि ये जो हमारी जो दूसरी अध्याय हमने लिखा है जिसमें कि सर्विस सेक्टर के जो नए कंपनियां हैं उनकी वृद्धि काफ़ी हुई है। अब आप जब देखें तो ये एक्चुअली डेटा कहाँ से है, ये हमारे डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल 504 डिस्ट्रिक्ट से डेटा आया है। तो ये माइक्रो डेटा जब आप एक्चुअली मैक्रो फैक्ट के साथ लें, क्या है मैक्रो फैक्ट, कि जो हमारी सर्विस सेक्टर है ये हमारी इकोनॉमी की एक बहुत बड़ी मजबूत नींव है, बहुत बड़ी कंट्रीब्यूटर है। ये माइक्रो डेटा मैक्रो के साथ तुलना में एक्चुअली पूरी कंसिस्टेंट है। तो आप इस अध्याय को और जो हम जो बड़ी पॉइंट कह रहे हैं, जो बड़ा मुद्दा हम बता रहे हैं कि जो हमने इस आर्थिक समीक्षा में बताया है, इसमें जो हमने बहुत केयरफुल एविडेंस दिया है, इसको भी ध्यान में रखा जाए जब भारत देश के आंकड़ों को लोग उसके बारे में कुछ कमेंट करते हैं। तो हमने जो बहुत बहुत ध्यान से एविडेंस दिया है उसको भी ध्यान में रखा जाए जब इसके बारे में कोई कमेंट करे।
नंबर 1919
वृष्टि फ्रॉम ब्लूमबर्ग न्यूज़। बोथ द वर्ल्ड बैंक एंड IMF आर प्रोजेक्टिंग अ 5.8% ग्रोथ नेक्स्ट ईयर। So what is it that you see in India's economic recovery and they don't? What are World Bank and IMF missing? And I have a second question. In the survey, you have spoken about some of the reforms that can be taken and some counter-cyclical fiscal policy measures. So could you please elaborate on that? What is realistic? What can the government do in next year?
I think on your first question, we've actually enough has been discussed, firstly. And secondly, I don't think it'll be apt for me to actually comment on other projections. Our projection is of 6 to 6.5%.
Last question, number 28.
Sir, main Shailesh hoon, ENI sir. सर, देश भर में जो अभी CA को लेके सोशल अनरेस्ट चल रहा है, वो क्या आपने इसको इकोनॉमिक सर्वे में फैक्टर इन करा है, और नहीं करा है तो क्या इससे ग्रोथ पर किसी तरह की असर पड़ेगा?
देखिए, हम तो इकोनॉमिक मुद्दों पे बात करते हैं और हमने जो आइडियाज़ बताई हैं ये इकोनॉमी के लिए है। इस पर मैं कुछ एक्चुअली टिप्पणी नहीं करना चाहूँगा कि मेरे दायरे के बाहर है।
Thank you very much.